Hello everyone, Athetos here, and yes, this is one more of those 3D6 videos. Last time we had a look at these small math coprocessor chips here. However, this time is all about modding, and yeah, the main topic is modding this motherboard from 128 kilobytes of CAS to 256. However, there are a lot of things going on here since last time. So let's first have a look before we go to our main topic. First of all, I added the socket here. I'm just preparing for my next video where I will try use this Cyrix 6486 DLC chip. But yeah, for now I'm still using the integrated AM386DX. Then I went here and I now have a permanent clock mode. So if you see here, I have completely removed the resistors and jumper and placed my own PCB. It is the same circuit I used on my previous videos, it's just that now it's a permanent solution. And yeah, this is quite good because it doesn't move, and I gained a little bit of stability by doing this way. This little device here will be available for you to buy soon enough, and I will come back to you with another video. Then, on my previous video, where I tested the different floating point units, there was a discussion about the maximum clock speed that was limited to 49.2 MHz when I was using a floating point unit. I researched this a bit, and yeah, the problem is the clock distribution network here of this motherboard is actually not that good. And the clock is delivered to the CPU in a better way, but for the floating point unit is quite poor. So for now I added here a pull-up resistor of 1 kilo-ohm to the clock input of the floating point unit. And that allowed me to finally run the system with the floating point unit at 50 MHz. This solution is by no means perfect. I have plans to completely replace and mod the clock distribution network here, but again, this is the topic for another video. So now to our main topic, the CAS mode here. And first of all, I want to talk a bit about CAS chips. These CAS chips come on different sizes, and all the models up to 256 kilobits are 28 4-pin chips, while larger chips of 512 or above are 32-pin chips. Now, 386 motherboards usually have 4 28-pin slots, so that means that the maximum CAS is 1024 kilobits, or basically 128 kilobytes. This is also the original configuration on my motherboard. Now, it's typical for 486 motherboards to have 8 of these sockets, or sometimes provide 4 and 4 of these larger sockets. So yeah, in general for 486 motherboards, depending on the chips you install, you can go higher to 256 or 512 kilobytes of CAS. Yeah, fortunately, of course, this is a 386 machine, so we have to work with these 4 sockets here. And on these sockets, yeah, in theory it's impossible to install a 32-pin chip. So I have to note here that on 32-pin chips, all the signals below the line here are more or less the same as the 28-pin one. There is a difference here, this is VDD, and the equivalent pin here is chip enabled 2. This is okay, as this signal should be connected to the VDD. So placing this chip in the 28-pin socket, we are left with these 4 pins here unconnected. And in the end, okay, these are not connected either way, so we don't care. And we have to provide the power supply here, and then we have this additional address line. Now, unfortunately, of course, in a 386 machine, this address line will not be routed on the PCB, and effectively you have to route it yourself. And yeah, this is how I did this mode here. These larger chips are placed on the previous sockets. The power supply is connected with a short wire directly here to the chip enable 2 that connects to the 5-volt rail of the motherboard. On the other side, I completely cut off the non-connected pins. And finally, I put here this wire that connects all the address 15 pins together. Finally routed this to the proper signal here. Now these chips are longer and we are colliding with this is a slot. So first of all I had to remove this, but this is a small sacrifice here. Now of course it's not only the cat chips you have to change. I also removed the tag chip, placed a socket there, and finally put a larger chip here. Now routing an address line like that is not the best thing. But okay, you don't have many options here. And in the end I didn't notice any instability. And that's all of this mode actually. Do I think that this is possible on any 386 motherboard? Probably not. And to tell you the truth, I would never try this if I wasn't sure that this would work. And the reason I was sure that this would work is because there is actually a 486 motherboard, the M601, that uses exactly the same chipset and the same BIOS, and is actually equipped with 256 kilobytes of CAS. So yeah, in the end there was very little room for failure here. So the mod worked on the first try, and here is the boot screen, and we have 80386DX with 256 kilobytes of CAS. Here is from SysView, and you can see the CAS speed and the memory speed, as well again 256 kilobytes of CAS. And finally here the CAS check tool with 256 kilobytes of CAS. So let's now see a few results. As I said, I was able to run my system with a math coprocessor at 50 MHz, and the system was stable. I will now show you only my Quake run. And yeah, here I have my full run. But of course the video is set up to 4x speed. Now this is of course my new record. I don't know, I cannot claim any 386 world records here. And the reason is that my motherboard is actually not the fastest one. In fact, it's probably one of the slowest ones. And the problem is the memory and CAS speed. As I said, this same chipset and BIOS is used in 486 motherboards. And I have seen comparisons there where this combo here is definitely the slowest one. So, okay, I have modded the hell out of this motherboard and achieved huge speed ups, but I still feel that I'm way behind. I'm now trying to source a bit more 386 motherboards and continue my work there. So we will probably see this on future videos. Either way, here's my result, it's 2.5 frames per second. And I have never seen something this high on a pure 386 machine. I have to note here that, okay, this 2.5 is a rounded result. But the good part is that we also have here the number of frames and the time it took to draw them. So if we divide the frames by the seconds, the actual result here is 2.47 frames per second. So now I will also have a very quick look at 3D bends with a score of 21.2. Chris 3D bends with a score of 10.8. Then PC Player Benchmark with a score of 5.1. And finally Doom with a score of 8020 real ticks. That's equivalent to 9.31 frames per second. So let's now have a look at all the results. And with 256 kilobytes of CAS, I did all my tests with a ULSI math coprocessor. Initially I used the same frequency. So the comparison is between this, that was our previous measurement, and this one. And we can see that 3D bends had a very small speed up, maybe 0.5%. PC player benchmark that was speed up by 0.1 frames per second. That can be anything up to, I don't know, 2-3%, but you never know because this is the rounding error. With Doom, things were a bit more clear and there was a 2.1% speed up. The VGA benchmarks, of course, had no difference. Cree's 3D benchmark, again, a very marginal increase in performance. But Quake again behaves like Doom with a 2.1% improvement. Then the floating point unit benchmarks had no difference. Maybe a small increase here in the lean pack, but that's all actually. So regarding 256 kilobytes of CAS on a 386 machine, the improvements are marginal and are mostly concentrated on Doom and Quake. So that is for today's video. Okay, there were not any significant improvements on speed, but either way I think this was an interesting mod to do. If you liked this video, you know what to do. And stay tuned because there are a lot more crazy stuff coming here in the next videos. So see you again next time.